It was not a silent night. There was blood on the ground. You could hear a woman cry in the alleyway that night on the streets of David's town. And the stable was not clean. And the cobblestones were little Mary, full of grace, there were tears upon her face, with no mother's hand to hold. It was a labor of pain. It was a girl on the ground in the dark. Every beat of her beautiful heart was a labor of love. Noble Joseph by her side, calloused hands and streets of David's
Yeah, it's a different blue bag, and there's something different inside. I bet you'll never guess what's inside. I don't think you'll be able to figure it out.
A cup?
No.
A tablet.
It's a tablet.
A tablet?
It's a phone.
Maybe a phone.
All right, let's check it out.
No, it's something because I can feel buttons.
Okay. Everybody sit down. Let's see what happens in here.
Yeah. What is that?
Easy.
It is a clock. Yeah. I bet if we could plug it in right over here. Y'all stay right there. There's a little plug in here. Ah. Here we go. See? It's a clock. Everybody can see. This is a special kind of clock. Now, a lot of people use phones now to set an alarm, but everyone used to use alarm clocks. You ever heard of an alarm clock? Do you hear your parents' alarm clock go off? What does yours sound like?
It's a howdy, beep, beep,
beep.
It's a beep, beep, beep.
Does your... It did. Oh, that's neat. Why do people use an alarm clock?
To wake up sometimes.
To wake up?
Like if they have to go somewhere at a certain time.
Well, everyone wakes up eventually. How come you have to have an alarm clock? What do you think? Very good, right? We have important things we've got to do, right?
Yep.
And what would happen if we slept too long?
Then you would probably miss it.
Right. You may not get to school. Or you may not get to church. Yeah, that's right. How many of you, your parents used an alarm clock this morning, or your grandparents?
My mom set up. She set it for a million times.
Oh, okay.
That's my
mom. A lot of people do that. A lot of people do that. Okay. The reason why I brought an alarm clock this morning is because we all need an alarm clock inside. Because we forget about Jesus so easily. It's kind of like falling asleep. When you fall asleep, you forget about everything that's happening in the world. We forget about Jesus. We forget about God. That's why we come to church. We come to church because church is kind of like an alarm clock that goes off and helps us to remember to get up and to follow Jesus. So let's pray to Him right now. God, please wake up our hearts. Wake us up and help us remember who You are and follow You this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank You. Sharon, now don't lie. When we were in the choir room, you told me just before you came out, do you remember what you said? I may play some bad notes here and there. I didn't hardly notice anything but one. Okay. Thank you. Let's pray. Father God, open our hearts. Wake us up to Your word. Help us to remember what's most important. In Jesus' name, amen. Tammy's best friend of many years, her name is Kelly, is a Korean girl by nationality. Her mother is Korean, and her father was an American GI in the Korean War. And for 15 years of knowing Kelly, she basically, her eyes were completely closed to anything about her parents or her childhood. She knew nothing about who her mother was, who her father was, other than a locket that she was wearing. It sounds like a little Orphan Annie, doesn't it? A locket that she was wearing when her mother gave her up for adoption. She doesn't know why. And she was loaded on a boat and brought to America, and a couple in America adopted her as a little child. How old was she? Like under 2 years old. So she remembered nothing. And our entire relationship, she loved her adopted parents, but she always wondered, why did my mother give me up? Who was my father? Was he a nice person? Did he love my mother, or was it a one-night stand, or what happened? How come he's not a part of my life? She didn't know. It was like she was asleep to that entire genesis of her life, those first years. Well, about 8 months ago or so, she decided to take one of these genetic tests. And online, she met someone who was closely related to her genetically. And she started talking to him, and he said, "Oh, I know who your father is." And of course, she thought, "Well, yeah, sure you do." But apparently, he did. And he had testing done as well. And he had been looking for her all these years. He had been married to his mother during the Korean War. And he had been pulled out of Korea and sent home, and she was supposed to follow him. And something happened. No one knows what. But she was never heard from again. And her daughter, Kelly, ended up for adoption. And so all of a sudden, after an entire lifetime, she has her own family now, a husband, she's active in her church. All of a sudden, she woke up to who she was biologically. That she had a daddy who was a career army veteran, and had fought in multiple conflicts, had his own family. He had remarried eventually. He had children, so now she has brothers and sisters. And they're able to meet, and they've had vacations together, and their families have gotten together. It's like her life just has come full circle. All this basically within just a year or two of her losing her adoptive parents. A little bit, something like that happens to us when we wake up to who we really are in Jesus Christ. Because we spend a lifetime gauging ourselves on our family here on earth. You know, I'm a part of this family, or this is what happened to me growing up, or I'm good at this, or I'm not good at that. I'm an American, I'm white, I am, you know, fill in the blank. I'm an Eagles fan, or a Redskins fan, or a Red Sox fan. We have all these ways that we categorize ourselves, and then we realize we are a child of the King. The creator of the universe actually made us and has been looking for us and loves us and sent Jesus for us. And when we ask Jesus to come into our lives as Lord, it's like waking up to the Father we didn't know that we had. Something like this happens to Joseph as we look at Matthew chapter 1. The first point from the same passage that Hillary and Ryan just read is simply this: wake up to who you really are. Wake up to who you really are. You notice in this passage, Joseph, as far as I could guess, thinks he knows who he is. Well, who is he? Well, he's a man. People argue about, well, was he a younger man or an older man? I don't know. We do know what he did for a living. He wasn't a Wall Street executive. He wasn't a military professional. What did he do for a living? He's a carpenter. It's a blue-collar job, worked with his hands. Was he rich or poor? Well, we know that too. Because from the Christmas story, if he was wealthy, he would have surely found a place to bring Mary. When he went to the temple, he wouldn't have bought turtle doves. He would have bought a more expensive sacrifice. He was poor, didn't have much of anything. He was a Jew. The whole world looked down on him. And as a Jew, he wasn't even particularly important. But he has his own dreams of having a life, having some bit of happiness. He finds a girl that obviously he cares about, and he's engaged to her. And engagements at this time, I mean, it actually was a marriage commitment. When you were engaged, to get out of the engagement, you actually had to get divorced. So even though the relationship hadn't been consummated yet, even though he hadn't taken her home from her family to the house he was probably working on for the two of them to start their own family, they were committed to be married. And somehow, in a small town, you can't hide things for very long. The word gets out when Mary comes back from mysteriously disappearing to visit her cousin. She comes back after 3 months and she has morning sickness, or she's showing, or word gets out somehow that she's pregnant. And how do you think Joseph feels? Boy, I mean, what a cocktail of emotions that must have been. He's probably angry. He's probably heartbroken. His whole life plan is going down the tubes now, because pregnancies only happen one way, don't you know? And he wasn't the father. So what happened? Well, it doesn't take a big leap of logic to figure that out. And so the passage that they just read concentrates on one night when everything just kind of comes to a head. He has been agonizing. What is he going to do? Now, under the law, he has a great many things at his disposal that he can do. Under the law of the Old Testament, actually, what could he do? He could publicly bring her before the elders. She could even be executed for unfaithfulness, for violating the covenant. At the very least, in a small town, her reputation is over. For the rest of her life, she will be humiliated, she will be looked down upon, she will be seen as that type of girl, and no one will have anything to do with her. And it's very interesting. Here you have a very rare combination of godlike traits in Joseph. In his mind, as he's heartbroken and angry and confused and probably praying and staying up all night trying to understand, what do I do? On the one hand, he wants to do the right thing. On the other hand, he wants to show mercy because he loves her. He cares about her. It says he was a righteous man. He was a just man. So rather than publicly humiliate her, of course the relationship can't go on, but he wants to hide this or do it very quietly so that she is not publicly humiliated. And maybe he finally comes to that conclusion and he drifts off to sleep. Has it ever happened to you where you're just pouring out your heart to God and you're praying in your bed alone at night, and then you drift off to sleep in the middle of the prayer? It's a great way to fall asleep. Well, he drifts off to sleep after he's decided, I'm going to divorce her, but I'm going to do it quietly because I don't want to hurt her. And someone visits him. in this dream. You ever had one of those dreams that just is different from other dreams? There's something in the vividness. There's something in the meaning. There's something powerful. Somehow God chose to touch him in this dream and speak to him in a way that was unmistakable to him. Angel of the Lord came to him and says this. What are the first words that the angel says in verse 20? Joseph, son of David. Joseph, son of David. Now, David had been dead. King David, you know, the ruler of Israel, the one who wrote a lot of the Psalms in your Bible, the one that started the dynasty that ruled Judah for hundreds and hundreds of years, the one from whom the Messiah would be born. That was a long way in the rearview mirror. And we're not talking about Joseph being royalty here. He's nothing. He's just a manual laborer. He's a carpenter. He's poor. And the angel says, Joseph, son of David. You know what that angel's doing? You know what God's doing right from the beginning? Wake up to who you really are. He's asleep, and yet he's going to wake up to who you really are. Remember, Joseph, for all present appearances, I know you're poor. I know you're looked down on. I know your reputation's up in the air. I know that you're not influential. I know you're just a manual laborer, but you're a son of the king. You are a son of the king, and from you, you are going to be a part of my plans to save the world from their sin, from themselves. I think many of us, myself included, have a similar thing going on in our lives. We have different problems in our lives. We have different challenges. Maybe it's a health crisis. Maybe it's a relationship problem like Joseph was having. Boy, what a relationship problem that is. And we try to struggle and figure out what we can do to make the best of it, just like Joseph is doing here. Maybe we even do it in a godly way, but we fall asleep for all the illusions and dreams of who this world says we are, and we forget who God makes us to be. You are a prince or a princess of the King of Kings. God has loved you to the uttermost, to the extent that he gave himself for you. Remember and wake up to who you are. How can I do that practically? Well, set your alarm clock. Set your alarm clock. There are all kinds of little alarm clocks that I use in my life to help me remember that I'm more than the pastor of Cobham Park Baptist Church or a father or a property owner or an American. I am a child of the King. I am loved by God. I am a follower of Jesus Christ. That identity is going to live on forever and ever and ever, long after this nation, long after this church, this earthly church, passes away. I will be living on in my Lord Jesus Christ. How do I wake up to that? Well, I set my alarm clock. This is what my Bible's for that I read in the morning and in the evening. This is what church is for. I tell you, I think sometimes God called me to be a preacher because I needed to be reminded on a continual basis who he is. If I were just somebody who was teaching Sunday school or someone in the church, I didn't have to prepare a sermon and I didn't have to be asked theological questions all day, I'd probably totally forget. I'd probably doze off. I admire you for staying in touch with who you are when you go out into the workplace and you go out into a world that has no memory of who God is whatsoever or who you are. I honor you for that, and I respect you for that. And how can you remember? Set your alarm clock. Don't think that you're going to be able to just wake up to who you are on your own. Remind yourself through prayer. Daily prayer. Remind yourself. Set your alarm by the company you keep. Set your alarm by active church involvement. Don't just be a spectator. Don't just be a pew warmer. Plug in. Plug in and let God really work to challenge you and help you remember and jog your memory to who you really are. Those little rituals mean so much. And the second thing, besides waking up to who you are, wake up to God's wonderful work. Wake up to God's wonderful work that is going on in your life, now my life, right now. Another friend of ours, her birthday was rolling around, and I think she was turning 50. And she was not happy about that milestone. Many of you are thinking, well, that sounds pretty young to me. Well, when you're turning 50, and you've never been 50 before, that can be traumatic for a young lady. So, she was turning 50, but she was happily married, and she had two beautiful children and three unruly dogs. And so she thought for sure someone would remember her birthday and do something to hug her or give her a present, especially her husband. Well, you know, she woke up in the morning, and she said, "Hello, good morning." He said, "Good morning. What's for breakfast?" And she thought, well, let's just see how long he goes before he remembers. So they go to the breakfast table, you know, and they're eating breakfast together. She's like, "So what do you have planned for today?" "Oh, nothing, really. Just going to go to work like I always do and, you know, come home. What do you think, we could watch a movie or something when I come home?" "No, that's right, a game's on. I'll be watching that." "Oh, really? You know, nothing else special?" "No, no, not really." And then later on in the day, he surprised her by saying, "Hey, you know, I'm going to town," after he got home from work. Let's go out shopping. "I've had some things I need to pick up." She's like, oh yeah. "Yeah, I'll go shopping." She's like, "Oh, there it is. There it is. He remembered, and he's going to take me out." They go out to Walmart. And he picks up some hunting gear or something. No mention whatsoever. She is hot. Not attractive hot. I'm talking angry, livid, ready to kill him. And she's just waiting for the right moment to completely unload on him about forgetting her birthday. Meanwhile, what she didn't know is that he had been spending months contacting all of her friends and making preparation for the mother of all surprise parties. We had our cars parked like a mile away and had to walk in through the woods. And we're all in her house. And I remember seeing her as she got out of the car as they came home. And she got out, she slammed the door. She's walking down the... And he's just kind of like, you know, laughing. And she comes in. And of course, we all yell, "Surprise!" And there's the meal, and there's the cake, and there's the... And then she killed him. No, anyway... Here's the thing. She woke up to her husband's wonderful plan that he had been putting in motion and preparing for months. And all the time it was going on, and she did not see it. And she didn't hear it. She was completely unaware of it. In fact, just the opposite. She believed that he was a loser, that he was a deadbeat husband, And actually, he loved her enough to spend a great amount of money. And the guy was cheap, okay? So this was a big deal. We do exactly the same thing with God. God loves surprises. Sometimes that drives us crazy, but he loves good surprises. I'm still trying to figure out all the surprise gifts he has unloaded in my life. I don't think I ever will until I see him face to face. And in fact, the times in your life where he seems most absent, and it seems like he has forgotten you, if you'll only remember to trust him, if you'll remember to wake up to God's wonderful work, you will begin to notice his preparations going on all around you in your life. And this is what happened to Joseph. Joseph thought that he was on his own in this world. He may have thought that God had forgotten about the Jewish people. I don't know. And yet we find, as the angel begins to share, that through the ages, God had been preparing the mother of all surprise parties. And it's a Christmas party. He himself, far from being far away and distantly removed from their problems, was closer than they could have ever anticipated. And for Joseph, he was really close. His fiance was carrying the Messiah of the living God that would save the world, and Joseph didn't even know it. And in fact, he's going to be called two names, it says here. The first one was what? Jesus, okay? Why? Jesus means save. God saves. Jesus is going to save all of us. Now, we would hope, just like we do today, that God's going to be a political savior, that God is going to be a nice homeowner improvement in our lives, that God's going to help us with this and that. No, God was going to come and save us from ourselves, from the very sin and selfishness in our hearts that separates us from God and from one another and from ourselves. Jesus, because he will save his people, and we are his people, from their sins. Not someone else's sins, our sins. And what's the other name? Emmanuel. God distant, God forgetful. What does Emmanuel mean? God with us. Wake up to God's wonderful work. In my first church, right after seminary, one of the men of that church that I was very close to was the choir director. His name was Glenn. And everyone loved Glenn. He worked as a prison guard, and he would come home late, just in time to arrive at choir practice. Inmates loved him. The choir loved him. He's just the kind of guy that everybody loved and respected. And Glenn discovered he had a brain tumor. And that tumor began growing until finally it put him in the hospital, and it was inoperable, and he was going to die. And that church prayed like I've never seen a church pray for Glenn's healing. And I, as a young pastor in my 20s, prayed for that man more than I think I've ever prayed for anyone. And I remember one night, like Joseph, all into the night, there on my bed, I was praying, please heal Glenn. And I fell asleep. And when I fell asleep, I had a dream. It was a very vivid dream. It was very different. This is the only time this has ever happened to me in my life. God usually doesn't communicate to me with dreams. But in this dream, I walked into the hospital to visit Glenn. And as I got on his hallway, there was a huge ruckus, and nurses were crowded in the hallway, and everybody was laughing and talking to one another. And as I got closer to his room, I heard nurses saying, I just can't believe it. I've never seen this before. This is amazing. As I got to his room, there was Glenn standing. And he came up to me and he said, I feel strong as an ox, Pastor. And I remember falling down on my knees in my dream and just praising God for healing Glenn. And then I woke up. And I got a phone call in a couple of hours that in the night, Glenn had died in the hospital room. And I was absolutely devastated. It was bad enough, I felt, that God had not answered my prayer. It was bad enough that God said no, but then I have this dream that he's healed, and the cruel disappointment and disillusionment of waking up and finding out he died at the same time I was dreaming this dream. And then I woke up again, and I realized that God was telling me that Glenn was free, and that Glenn was alive in a way that he had never been alive before, and that God had not shared that with me for me to have an emotional experience, but to comfort a church that would have been devastated otherwise. And God used that dream to bring himself glory and to show love and to wake us up to his wonderful work that he has done in Jesus Christ. It's a little bit of what he's doing in our lives all the time. He's much closer than you think he is. Refuse to hold God hostage to your understanding. That's what I want to do. I'm a guy who loves to figure things out. I mean, I buy books when I don't need books, just so I can figure out some more stuff. And you know, I'm old enough to know I'm never, praise God, going to figure him out. Because he is far more than I could ever dream of. And he's able to answer our prayers in a way that are far better than anything I could even ask for myself. He'll do the same for you. Wake up to who you really are. Wake up to God's wonderful work. And here's the most important thing, church. Here's the most important thing, Keith. After you wake up, get up. After you wake up, get up. How many times have we laid in bed in the morning and we wake up and we begin to think about all the things that we need to do and we want to get up and we plan to get up, but we lay in the bed a little longer. Amen? I do the same thing with God. You see, with God, it's not enough to wake up and believe that he is who he says he is. The Bible says in James that even the demons believe and shudder. Even the demons believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and it scares them to death. So if you think that just believing that God exists, that just believing in your mind that Jesus came to save you is enough, get up. Don't just wake up. Faith without works is dead. It's not enough to want to get up and follow Jesus. It's not enough to just want to do better. Get up. It's not enough to intend to get more serious about God, to make a resolution, to make a plan. Get up and follow God. A beautiful, beautiful verse in verse 24 of chapter 1 of Matthew. Matthew 1, 24. Listen to this. When Joseph woke from sleep, what does it say? He did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but didn't know her until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. I don't think he felt like doing that, in some ways. He knew he was going to pay a heavy social price. When he took Mary as his wife, you know what he was publicly doing? How would people have understood that act? That child is Joseph's. Joseph couldn't even wait until his wedding day. Man, he didn't have control. And in a society like this, with very different social mores than what we're used to here, that was a big deal. And this was a small town. Everybody was going to know about it. Even in Warsaw, even in this town, I bet you know people who did something in their teenage years and now they're 80 years old and people are still talking about what they did. Amen? A small town never forgets. It's like you're doomed for the rest of your life to be known for something that happened to you decades and decades ago. Amen. I'm so glad you didn't know me in Stafford County, my teenage years. Don't talk to my dad at all, okay, about that. So Joseph, though, woke up. He woke up and he got up to follow Jesus. Now, I share that because week after week, I believe sometimes I hear about what God requires of me. I know what God is challenging me to do. I tell myself, I think I'm going to get serious about this sin in my life. Or I think I'm going to read my Bible more. Or I think I'm going to become more active in the church in this way. Yeah, pastors think that too. But until I actually get up, what does that even mean? And some of you here, week after week, hear about Jesus and you think, one of these days I'm going to join this church. One of these days I'm going to be baptized. You know, I think pretty soon, maybe in 2019, I'm going to walk down the aisle and pray. Or maybe I'm going to get right with God. If you wake up, get up. Without getting up, what good does it do to wake up? Father God, give us the strength not only to wake up, but to get up. And I thank you that you've loved us, that you've looked for us, and that you have found us this morning, that you found me. And I thank you that you're all around in my life if I only just trust you and watch and listen and move in what you've already shared with me. Open my eyes, Lord. I want to see you. And I want to follow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we sing. Have faith in God, number 405.
Thank you.
Go from this place. Awake. Awake to who God is and who you are. Father God, I pray that you give us the blessing of wakefulness, of alertness. Help us to go from here watching and listening, not present appearances, but the reality that's deeper than that of who you are. In Christ's name, amen.